You may have heard the term story branding being thrown around either online or videos or whatnot and wondered, well, what the heck is that? Does that apply to my business? Can it help me? Well, we're going to cover all of that on today's episode. But hey, if you're interested in an insider's take on branding in the creative industry, be sure to stick around. Hit the like button, subscribe so you don't miss out. I'm Steve Reed, and this is Brand or Die. So first off, we get the term story branding from this book by Donald Miller called Building a Story Brand. This is a really, really great book. I've enjoyed it quite a bit. It has really revolutionized the way I handle branding with my clients. And the model that is presented there is kind of at the core of the entire brand architecture that I will build for the people that I work with. So the first thing that's important to understand about the story brand is it's literally built around the whole concept of a story.
It's only a story. It's not real. It's only a story.
It's something like the hero's journey, if you're familiar with that. And stories go back to the very, very beginning. We've always been a storytelling species, right? We etch our stories onto rocks. We've written it on papyrus. It's been acted out in plays. And it goes all the way back. You think about all the things that really captivate our attention. Most people can't sit still for 2 seconds to listen to somebody explain something of value, but people will sit down for 2 hours. They'll sit down for 4 hours. They'll sit down for 10 hours and stream an entire season of a show, all of the episodes, right? Because we're captivated by stories. We invest in the characters and we want to see what happens to them. We care about it. And we almost live vicariously through those experiences. This is a really important thing to understand because it's at the psychological foundation of why this is effective and why it really works. Now, a lot of people, I see this over and over again, people come to me and they go, hey, I want a website, I want a logo, and they just want to throw stuff out there and do the same old generic thing that everybody else is doing. And I mean, sometimes people get lucky, you know, every now and then a squirrel finds a nut, but it's not a good strategy to just wing it and guess with your business. You want to have some type of plan. And if you could come up with a plan that could vastly increase your odds of connecting with an audience and finding success, then why not do that? And so a lot of these things are not terribly difficult to do. So what we're going to be talking about today in this episode is we're going to be covering the basic elements of a story brand to where you can take some of these principles and run off and do some of these things yourself. Now, at some points, it does get more complex and you may need the assistance of an expert, a branding person who's familiar with this to help you along that path. But there are some things that I think you can do yourself and you could start changing right now today that could make huge impacts in how you run your business. So I'm sure you've all seen some image like this at some point in your life. You've got the villain with the mustache. He's always in a top hat, dressed nicely for some reason. And he's tying up the damsel in distress to the railroad tracks. And then you've got the hero. The hero comes in to save the day and save the damsel for the villain. This is the mistake I think that a lot of businesses make, is what they've done by putting themselves as the hero, they've put their audience as the damsel in distress. Let's say you're trying to sell a product or your service and you're like, hey, we're the hero. We're going to come in and we're going to save the day. You're the damsel in distress. Now, sometimes we feel like the damsel in distress, but I think when we go and watch movies, we're not always immediately identifying with that victim in distress that needs saving. We want to identify with the hero. We like the powers that the hero has and the boldness the hero has. It inspires us. Nobody sits around getting inspired about simply being rescued as a victim. Maybe some people might, and maybe some stories can weave that in there. You could do some creative things, of course, the vast majority of the stories, people are going to identify with the hero's journey. Everything is about the hero. That is the unfortunate thing here, is if your business is the hero, then your customers are the victim, the damsel in distress. But here's a question for you, and this is what the whole story brand framework proposes, is what if we put the customer as the hero? We identify a villain, but the customer is a hero. And we are all about helping that hero achieve their goal. So where does the business fit in now? If we're not the hero and the customer is the hero, what about us? So here's a little illustration of kind of how the story brand framework works. So our hero in this model is the customer. They are the ones that have the problem and they need help with it. They can't do it themselves, but they need to be empowered to do it, to achieve that victory. So they meet a guide, and we're the guide. That's us. That's the role that we're taking. We have the solution to the problem, or a way that the hero can solve their own problem. So we give them a plan, and that plan of action helps them do that. If they follow the plan, then they're going to be successful. And so we call them to action. That's the next step. Now that they have a plan, they need to be called to action and go on that journey. And that journey will end in success, and it will avoid a very specific failure. So there's this transformation that happens. And one of the great examples of a hero's journey story that fits within the story brand framework is Star Wars. You got Luke Skywalker. He's the hero. He's got a problem. The Empire is cracking down. He really hasn't felt the effects of it too much in his life, but the Empire comes in looking for the droids as they wipe out his family, and now he's got nobody. And he's met Obi-Wan, who is the guide here, and he gives Luke a plan. You use the Force. He teaches him a little bit how to use his lightsaber, and he pushes him on this path. If he uses the Force, if he trusts the Force and he grows in his discipline, he will be able to do something against the Empire. So he gets this call to action to go and take down Darth Vader, and it ends in success, at least in A New Hope. They blow up the Death Star. They've crippled the Empire by destroying their big flagship weapon. And so it's a huge victory. They get awards. Poor Chewbacca gets gypped on that. Chewbacca probably should have got a medal too. He was a hero, but he stands there anyway. And then it avoids failure of the Empire being able to use this weapon to cause catastrophic damage and continue in their path to take over the galaxy. So another example of this model would be the Lord of the Rings. This is another great example, another classic. You've got Frodo Baggins, and he's got a problem. He has this magic ring that's come across his path, and that Sauron's been growing. There have been rumors and things like that, but this ring confirms that something bad is coming. And the Nazgul are coming to the Shire, causing havoc everywhere they go. So he's got to get it out of there. And so he meets the guide, which he already knows in this case, which is Gandalf. And Gandalf gives him a plan. They got to go and throw the ring into Mount Doom. It has to be destroyed in the same fires that it was created from. But he's called to action. A fellowship is put together, and they go on this quest to try to take that ring into Mount Doom. And it ends in success. He's able to return to the Shire, live his life again, which, I mean, in the story, he goes to the Undying Lands and everything in the story, but he restores peace to the Shire. He has success. He accomplishes his goal in the end, and it avoids the failure of Sauron basically taking over and ruling everything and destroying all of Middle Earth. So this is a great classic example of some of these stories. But how does this translate over into your business? You're like, well, I sell tamales. How is this going to translate over to what I do, right? Let's look at a couple examples. Let me show you a couple of websites real quick. So this first one, this is Eagle Technology. And look, I'm not trying to bash any of these websites. There are good things about them, but I'm just focusing on the story brand framework here. So let's look at what they're doing. This website, I would say, is not built upon the story brand framework. It features a lot of the classic stuff you'd see on a typical website. Gunshot detection system, patented technology, developed by the Department of Energy. And then there's this graphic back here. Like, what is this? It's this swirling thing. And it looks like it comes straight out of Mario Kart. What does this have to do with gunshot detection? Number one. But again, more importantly, who is this for? Who is this targeting right here? This website. Gunshot detection system, patented technology developed by Department of Energy. Okay, what's the story? There's no story here. Who's the character? They're the hero. They've got this, they're bragging about this thing that they have. It's gunshot detection. Oh, awards. Look at all these awards. Why is the audience here going to care about this? Well, it could say, all right, well, look how good we are, everything. Okay, great. That's wonderful. But what does this have to do with me? Innovation to stop active shooters. Okay, that's what I want. But then down here, we've got some news, some videos. This is actually good, what they're doing here. They're bringing people into the story. So we're starting to get a little bit of a story, how detection systems work, a new approach to gunshot detections. So a lot of this is all about us, accuracy, flexibility. There's a lot of text. It's talking a lot about the product here. And then contact us today. So you may look at that and say, what's wrong with this? Now, the reason I picked this one is this is certainly not the worst that I've seen, but it's just a good example of something I want to contrast with another solution. Now, here's another solution right here where we have a company called OmniAlert. Now, the design of all of this, I wouldn't say is top notch, but I want you to look at the content here. Active shooter protection. Look at the word protection. How it's highlighted, even with the brand color here. Protection. This is what people want. This is what the audience wants. Now, look at this right here. Save, request, identify. There's verbs that are being used all over this page here. There's a gun, a person holding a gun. This is the bad guy. This is the villain. You see the difference between these two? Where you've got the villain right here. So save lives. Who's going to be saving the lives? The audience is. They're going to be saved. They're going to be empowered to do this. Request a demo. Who's requesting the demo? They are. Identify gun threats at first sight. Who is identifying the gun threats? The audience is. Down here, respond instantly to emergencies. Who's doing the responding? The audience. A partner you can trust. They've got some other people here. That's fine. That's great. We're getting into the topic of website strategy a little bit, which isn't entirely necessary. That's not the whole point. But you see this, discover the right gun detection tool for you. Protect your organization. Protect your people today. So the messaging here is really, really good. Now, I think there's a lot of things they could have done better in terms of design and the visual identity of the brand and how they would convey certain things. But I want you to notice the difference between these two. Because on the one hand, you have one company talking a lot about itself. On the other hand, this language here is talking about empowering the members of the target audience, making them the hero and the company being the guide that's going to help them do these things. I love the strategy of utilizing verbs as the first word in some of these headlines. I think it's great. Now let's go to this Nepesh Pilates. This is a really great site. This is another site that's clearly built upon the StoryBrand methodology. So we get to see some of these patterns again here. The workout your body needs to live the life you want. That's such a great headline right there. Join East Sacramento's only classical Pilates studio, right? So we got join, another verb right here. Book your intro. Feel energized. Find strength. Gain confidence. I know that these guys have done their research. They've done their customer interviews. They've looked at the things that people value the most and what they're looking for in why they want to get involved in Pilates in the first place. And they're highlighting these probably top three things that came out of that user research, which you definitely want to do your customer interviews and stuff. I do that with my clients. But look at this. Feel. find, gain. Again, verbs that the people are doing. This is outstanding. Move beyond the class routine. Group classes can be fun, but they have their limitations. Yada, yada. You deserve a place to work on your personal fitness goals, not your neighbors. This is a philosophical statement here. You deserve a space to work on your personal fitness goals. And if your philosophy, if you're like, yeah, I do deserve that, you align with them on that. That's all part of the entire framework. Once you start getting down into the weeds of it, the mind body workout you've been looking for. And again, look at these pictures. There's a woman here. She's messing around. This whole site's very, very feminine. There's a guy in there too. Doesn't mean that guys can't go there, but obviously your target audience is females about this age. They're getting that personal attention, great use of photography, showing this personal training. This feels like a safe and comfortable place. Our members inspire. Here's a woman with looks like a baby and someone holding a little quote sign things. Getting started is simple. And remember that when the hero meets, the guide gives them a plan. So here's the plan, 1, 2, 3. And it's beautiful to be able to summarize your plan into three things. Even if your plan has like 400,000 steps, summarize it down into three. That way it looks simple to the user. And granted, at the end of the day, people are willing to put forth the work and do multiple steps if what you have is something that they really want. But that doesn't mean you need to show a billion steps on the page. Like when you see advertising to go on a vacation, my wife's always showing me these pictures of Bali where they have these little huts out on top of the water. You've probably seen these before. There's a pool on the deck and you can just slide right into the water and it's crystal clear blue-green water with fish and things underneath, and it looks amazing. And that's what they're selling, is go here and be here. Now imagine if that ad instead said something like, imagine waking up at 3 a.m. and getting into your car and driving to the airport through all of the intense traffic. Imagine now standing in an insanely long line of smelly people waiting to get patted down and molested by the TSA in order to sit on your tiny little cramped seat for a 12-hour flight, eating peanuts and crappy snacks. And then finally getting to your destination where you'll be haggled at the airport by a million people offering you taxi services and your luggage not showing. Like, you don't talk about that part of the thing. You're like, hey, do you want to go here? Yes. Book your flight, pack your bags, and enjoy your vacation, right? You summarize it down into three things. So here we have book your intro, join studio sessions, feel your best. That's the outcome that you want, is to feel your best. There's a little sun rising there. It's wonderful. What are studio sessions? So they're going to explain a little bit in case you need it. Then they got a free guide. Let's say you're not ready to book that intro yet. It's still a little bit scary to you. So what they do is they give you another call to action, something you could easily do right now in the safety of your own home. You can download this free guide. Look at this, 5 exercises for Pilates beginners. Hey, I can maybe try that in my house right now. Maybe I'll do that. I got some free time. Let me enter my email address and get this information. Maybe they do these exercises and go, wow, that made me feel really good. I want more. This whole website, the way that they are pitching the studio, targeting the audience, and speaking to them is just really brilliantly executed. I came across this site a while back. I just keep coming back to look at it because it's just so well done on so many levels. And so that's a really good example of how you can build that story brand methodology into what you're doing. A lot of it is simply how you are speaking to your audience and how you're positioning your brand, your company, as the guide, helping them get what they want. And when it spills over into social media and all of these other things, you can expand on this storyline. You can hit little aspects of it, but you can identify through a process how each one of these parts of the story apply to your business and your customers, and really start to flesh it out a little more. And I mean, what I do is I take it beyond that. I start looking into the brand personality archetype. There's 12 different personality archetypes. that you can choose from. And it's kind of like a personality test for your business where you determine how your business is going to interact with your customer. Are you funny? Are you serious? Are you very caring and loving? Are you more seductive? What's the tone in which you're speaking to those customers? How can they connect with that? And you can use personality traits to speak to your audience. And people will connect a lot more deeply to a business if it has that personality defined. Otherwise, you just risk confusing people. Because I see this happen a million times, especially as a business grows and where you have partners in the business. Because different partners, you guys are going, you're doing your stuff. You're looking at other businesses you admire, people doing things, or, oh, let's try that. It's working for them. Let's do that. And then so you start being a little crass and a little irreverent maybe. But then you start to find, oh, that's maybe turning off a segment of our audience. We don't really know who our audience is. We're just trying to get customers. So then you start to be really serious and inspirational. And it starts to get crazy after a while. And then your audience, they don't know what the heck you are and what you stand for. You're all over the place. And it's very confusing. And so you want to be able to have some type of strategy or plan in place to be able to tackle that. But just on a day-to-day level, like what you can do right now is simply sketch out these 7 parts of this framework and start to fill in and flesh those out. And I really encourage you to just buy a copy of this book. You can execute a lot of this stuff on your own. Maybe you're just looking for a way to dip your feet into it and start making a couple of changes. Kind of like this Pilates studio page where it's like, hey, there's 5 exercises that you can do. The book is a great start. It's going to help you figure out some really key things that you need to have in place. And if you need help with it, if you're like, wow, I'm getting stuck. I'm not sure how to do X, Y, and Z. And if you really need a comprehensive approach, then you're going to need to talk to a branding person, a marketing person, somebody has that kind of background. That's it for today. I hope there was some value in today's show for you. There's a lot more that you can learn about this. There's videos on YouTube. There's blogs. There's all kinds of information out there that can help you get started. This was just kind of a basic introduction. But yeah, I think it's a very powerful tool to use. And when done right, it can literally just revolutionize your business and how you do things. If you're trying to connect with an audience and grow your business, this is something that absolutely can make a big help. But hey, if you like today's show, if you understood the StoryBrand concept and sounds thrilling to you, hey, give this video a like. Feel free to subscribe, hit that notification bell so you don't miss out, and join us on the next episode of Brand or Die.